Well, thank you very much to Dr. Baker for a very, very compelling presentation. We all feel your pain, I'm sure. So it is my pleasure to introduce the next speaker, whom I've known for many years. Dr. Paul Chekhel is director of the Southern California Evidence-Based Practice Center site at the RAND Corporation. He's a consultant in health sciences at RAND, professor of medicine at the UCLA School of Medicine, and a staff physician at the Veterans Administration Medical Center in West Los Angeles. And his research focus has been in the application of innovative methods to the assessment and improvement of the quality of care. And I've had the pleasure of working with Paul in his role as the co-chair of the editorial board for the Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality National Guideline Clearinghouse and National Quality Measures Clearinghouse Editorial Board.
So the title of this talk, as you can see, is Can We Make Producing Practice Guidelines More Efficient? And if we can, how will we know if the methods are trustworthy? So first, some disclosures. I have some research funding from the usual suspects. And also, as Vivian told you, I am the co-chair of the editorial board for the National Guidelines Clearinghouse, and I also receive a few $100 a year from UpToDate for having co-authored a couple of chapters for them. Now, to get into the talk, okay, so the Institute of Medicine produced a report, okay, and said, here are some criteria by which we're going to judge whether guidelines are trustworthy. They're based on a systematic review, they're developed by a multidisciplinary panel, they consider a proportion of patient subgroups, they're based on explicit and transparent processes, et cetera, et cetera. I know GIN has its own version of this, and but the differences between the GIN version and the IOM version are not material for this talk, so I'll just go with this for now. Now, in terms of developing a guideline new from scratch, your organization has never been done it before, I'm not going to give you any good suggestions for that. I don't know of any shortcuts yet in how to do it and stay within these criteria. But what I am going to talk about is about updating. And these two in particular, being based on a systematic review and being developed by a multidisciplinary panel, seem like good targets for increasing efficiency for updating. Now, also, I'm not going to be talking about looking for triggers about when a guideline needs to be updated. I've presented before at this group about the methods that we've looked at for triggers and how we validated those. And so those are not things I'm going to be talking about. I'm going to be talking about what to do in terms of updating. So machine learning for the searches. Now, this does not originate with me, okay? There's many other groups doing this, and I certainly acknowledge Tom Tricolinos, now at Brown, then at Tufts, for introducing me to this topic. But the machine learning that he was showing me was about doing it de novo from scratch the first time. And the application that we've chosen to pursue is a little bit different. It's about using it for updating the search, the original search. Okay, so this takes advantage of the decisions made in the literature search and screening process, all right? So what you need is you need the original citations from the original search, and then you need what went in, what actually contributed as evidence to the original report or the original systematic review. So for example, if you had 5,000, I mean, this would be sort of a typical kind of one that we do. There's 5,000 citations in the initial search. 50 of them end up getting included as evidence. 4,500 end up not being included as evidence when all is said and done. And these end up being the true positives, and the others end up being the true negatives. Now, I am not the person who writes these programs, okay? And I do not know anything about the analytics, all right? And so I'm going to tell you what they tell me they do, all right? And but in order to find out what they do, it's going to be somebody other than me that's going to need to answer that. There's different, as I understand it, there are different methods of machine learning. And this method, the so-called bag of words, is the one that our analysts are using. And as well as I can tell, the bag of words takes everything, all the words that are in the citation, the indexing, the abstract, whatever's in that, all right, for the true positives and compares them to the false positives and then develops a prediction model, okay? Which then they then apply to the updated search, okay? So you construct a prediction formula, it gives you a rank order of the predicted probability of the thing being a relevant citation, and then you draw a line, right? And so you draw a line using the original stuff to make sure that everything that you wanted is above the line, all right? And then you wouldn't have needed to screen everything below the line, okay? So how well does the method work? Well, we tested our first version of this retrospectively on two AHRQ supported comparative effectiveness review updates, one for low bone density and one for atypical antipsychotic drugs. Now, this work is published, and these are tables from the published paper. Now, ignore the one on the right, okay? This was testing two methods. The one on the right didn't work so good, all right? Or at least it didn't work as well as the one on the left. The one on the left, what it shows you for these atypical antipsychotics is that you could pick a threshold which would have one false negative, but would decrease by more than, or about 50% the total of number of things you had to screen, all right? And that in this one on low bone density drugs, osteoporosis drugs, you could pick a threshold that would miss 20, okay, and you'd only have to screen 10% of it, okay? Now, what were these false negatives? Well, for low bone density, at this probability of 0.02, 26 false negative, 25 were not randomized trials. They were meta-analyses, case control studies, retrospective analyses of claims databases, things like that. It did miss one true positive RCT about raloxifene, okay? And because it was tagged as being pharmacology rather than something more specific, and so it wasn't picked up by the approach. For atypical antipsychotic drugs, at the probability of 0.01, only one false negative was occurred, and that's because it was tagged as a letter, all right? But it would have been detected by reference mining and things that were included. Now, this original version that we used, okay, required index terms that could only be used on MedLab. And we realized, and based on these results, we said, we kind of want to do better, we want something that will be more generalizable, we can use it on MBase. And so we came up with another version. Alright? Now, in this version, we applied this prospectively. Okay, so what I just described to you was we'd already done the update, we already knew what was going to be the true positives and the false and the true negatives in the update, and they built the model based on the prior report and then see how well it would have performed on an update. Now, in this one, we did a little different. Okay, we compared three different updating search strategies. Okay, we use this new method, one that is more bad words, didn't require these other kinds of things that you needed in order to make the first one work. We developed the machine learned predictions using the original set, set the sensitivity, okay, such that all the studies that were in the original search would be identified using that threshold. And then we ran three separate screens side by side. So we had the full Monty, okay, so that's just like the original search. That's 12,000 citations, okay? Then we had the machine learned version of that, okay, which was 2,000 citations. And then we also ran it side by side, something that we call the surveillance method, which is uses a limited number of journals, and that was 2,800. And we had separate people review these. Now, we didn't use dual review because this was unfunded work here. And we weren't really going to dually review 12,000 citations, but we had three experienced single reviewers review these. All right, 34 articles ended up being included in the update. 32 of those were identified by the full Monty approach. 33 were identified by the machine learning approach, and 14 were identified by the surveillance method approach. So what was missed? All right. Well, here's an example of where the machine learning might actually be potentially better than the full Monty kind of method, because with 12,000 titles, that screening was done by one titles first, then abstracts. And there were two titles that were rejected at the title stage because they weren't viewed as being likely to have data. Those two titles were picked up at the machine learning stage because with only 2,000 titles, that person reviewed titles and abstracts together, so they had both things in front of them. Right? The one title that was missed there was something that was included in the report as evidence supporting the overuse of DEXA scans. I mean, it's almost, I mean, it certainly wasn't evidence the same way that evidence about effectiveness or harms is, but it was definitely something that was important. So to be fair, I count it as a false negative. And then the surveillance method, there were 20 titles that were all published, and they were published in journals that aren't part of the surveillance method, but none of them pivotal in changing the conclusions. So now we tested it again. Now, so that was one test that worked okay, all right? But the only way to understand how this works, it's a little bit like self-driving cars, okay? I mean, you gotta kind of use it over and over again to start figuring out where it's gonna work and where it's not gonna work, all right? And so we tested again. This was on a gout management, on a systematic review done for a clinical practice guideline that's coming out from the American College of Physicians on gout management. And so it had 14 questions. You can see them up here. In the original report, you can see it had 6,500 titles, and there ended up being 25 includes for acute gout, 19 on hypercuricemia, 8 for monitoring, and 3 about discontinuation. So in this case, we used the same one that we used for the low bone density, the bag of words approach. It doesn't require indexing. There was 1,134 titles on the update search. 11 of these ultimately ended up being included in the update. 10 were identified by the machine learning version, and the machine learning version only had 143 titles in it. Okay, so it was an 80-some percent reduction in the number of titles. The one title that was missed, okay, was a research letter that assessed the association between this particular genetic marker and risk of allopurinol toxicity and severe skin reactions. And that's an association which was already extensively reported on in the report. So again, worked pretty well. So the conclusions that we've got so far is that machine learning has a substantial promise as a method to increase the efficiency of update search. Might decrease the screening by, or will decrease the screening by at least 50%, maybe as high as 80%. Okay? Obviously, it's going to be most useful for things that have a lot of hits. If your original search, you know, only included 1,000 titles, you know, and your update search has 150 titles, it's not worth going through the process of building a machine learning method for this. Reference mining of the included studies still should be performed, okay, because it will help potentially identify things that might have been false negatives in the machine learning. Some false negatives are going to occur. I don't think this is ever going to get down to be perfect, okay? But in our experience, none have been pivotal. And when you consider that two groups, when asked to do a systematic review on exactly the same topic, don't ever include quite the same studies, I think that this has been performing relatively well. The other thing is that I expect it's going to get continually better as you do more and more update searches on the same topic. I expect the most advantage to come in this first round, but I suspect if we ever, God forbid, have another opportunity to review the low bone density literature, that we can refine that algorithm even more. So let's go on to multidisciplinary expert input. Well, methodologically, this is a much harder thing to study, okay? And that's because expert panel processes by themselves have their own variability as part of the process. So there have been a lot of studies of this kind of thing. The Kappa statistic for the chance-corrected agreement is somewhere in the 0.5 to 0.8 range, so sort of moderate to close to pretty good reliability. And so what that means is that anytime you want to compare sort of whatever your traditional method is with some other method, there's always going to be a trouble trying to interpret those results unless you've done so many replications of the same thing, okay, so that you know what the interpanel variation is and what this interpanel variation is, and then you can compare them across, and we frankly don't have those kinds of resources. So what are some alternative ways to the traditional face-to-face method? That I'm abbreviating that FTF. Well, there's been an experimental study of this where it was all done by mail. Okay, so everybody got mailed out things that they were supposed to rate and comment on, etc. And at least in these two applications, it didn't perform that bad. Okay, but for both of these applications, it was not quite equivalent to what a guideline process would be, in that they were given prepared statements, which they then had to rate. So it wasn't developing new statements. So my version of this is that's probably a substantial overestimate of what would happen if you actually tried to create a guideline that way. Now, online moderated facilitated formal ratings, okay, again, we've done one experiment on there, and Kappa wasn't so good, and more like 0.4, but it was a very hard topic. It was, the topic was, again, this isn't a guideline per se, but the process is relevant. The topic was picking out the characteristics that made continuous quality improvement, and that turns out to be a much harder thing than you think it would be in terms of being able to recognize what those are. But also, there's this issue about the drop-off in participants between rounds, okay? So that initially 60% of the people invited agreed to participate, okay, and participated in round one, but then only 62% of those participated in round two, and of those, only 87% then participated in round three, which was the final round. And so you have 36% of the original invitees, but even more a little disturbing to me, you only had 54% of the people that participated in all three rounds. So those are all things that I have evidence and I have quantitative numbers to show you. I'm going to switch over to some observations from having 25 years of experience in running expert panels through a variety of different methods. And one of the things that we observe often is when we initially mail things out, we collect some opinions initially about potential guideline kind of recommendations. Sometimes we'll get back, everybody agrees, yeah, this is something, this thing should be done. And then when we bring them together for a face-to-face panel meeting, they start rethinking that, and they start saying, well, but maybe not in this situation. And then somebody says, some of them maybe not here. And how do we really define that? And pretty soon something that had complete agreement at the mail round, okay, that it was something that should be a recommendation and should be done, completely falls apart, and it ends up not being a recommendation at all. So I believe that that using non-face-to-face methods are going to perform differently, okay, depending on what's being asked, okay? So reaffirmation of the status quo or minor changes, I think it's likely to work pretty well, okay? But development of entirely new recommendations, I would be very cautious about that until I had really good data that I could trust in. So my conclusions on this is that expert input probably doesn't always have to be gathered via face-to-face meeting. Okay, so we've used teleconference, we've used online methods like SurveyMonkey, we use online moderator facilitating methods like Expert Lens, and some of them have been successful, more successful, some have been a little bit less successful. But I think that there's probably a role for these kinds of things. But I would be more hesitant, I'd be more worried about them when they're being used for something de novo. So I think that the non-face-to-face methods are going to be most trustworthy when they reaffirm existing guideline statements, they make minor modifications like adding or subtracting drugs or adding or subtracting harms. But again, I think at least some kind of synchronous communication, maybe not a face-to-face, but a large teleconference, are still going to be required for major changes in guideline recommendations. Now, we're going to need new criteria to assess whether updated guidelines are trustworthy. So remember the ILM criteria, all right? Imagine the following situation, which I don't think is implausible because, in fact, I've heard this same idea suggested. Okay, a developer commits to producing a continuously updated guideline or a living guideline. And this is going to be monthly or quarterly or some kind of periodic, weekly. Searches are done for new relevant evidence. The new relevant evidence is then sent to the technical expert panel, and then the technical experts reaffirm the validity of the existing guideline recommendation, or they modify the recommendations to reflect new evidence. So this is something that's been proposed, okay? And it sounds reasonably good, but there's going to be some issues that we're going to have to figure out, okay, as to what's going to count as trustworthy. So, these monthly or quarterly searches that are done for new evidence, is this equivalent now to the ILM criteria being based on a systematic review? So what kind of search was performed? Okay, was it a full search, a surveillance search, a machine search? Were titles screened in duplicate? I mean, if you think about the companion ILM document about what is a systematic review, that has a very long list of requirements, all right? How many of those got to be followed in order to make it trustworthy that this continuously updated or living guideline is trustworthy? Okay, the new evidence is sent to the technical expert panel for the review. Well, what was sent to them? Was it just the original studies? Here are four new studies we found. Okay, you know, what do you think about them? Okay, was a critical appraisal of these done? How is this new evidence presented compared to the existing evidence? Again, remember the IOM criteria is being based on a systematic review. What is going to count as being based on a systematic review in this kind of model? Then the technical experts, you know, reaffirm the validity. So how was this input collected? Was it collected by a survey? Was it collected over the phone? Was it collected in face-to-face panel meeting? And in particular, how many of the experts from the original guideline panel participated in all the rounds of the deliberation to lead to whatever the final product is? I'm worried, okay, that in things that are done, that if you send out this, if you sent out a thing where you said, here's 10 new pieces of evidence, and maybe we wrote up a little summary of it, and you send it out to your 10 technical experts from the original guideline panel, that you're going to get back 6 responses, or you get back 5, or you get back 7, and then maybe there's another little iteration, and maybe 4 people respond to that. And that's not the same way that it happens in creating the original guideline with the face-to-face panel. So, can we make practice guidelines more efficient? Can we make producing practice guidelines more efficient? Again, as I said, with respect to the de novo thing, I don't have any good ideas on that right now. But I think that is possible in terms of updating, okay, with regard to searching for new evidence. But we're going to need to have criteria by which we're going to know whether these are trustworthy or not, all right? For the searches, I think it is possible to validate new methods, and I've showed you what some of our limited work has been on that area. So I think that only methods that have been validated are going to be able to be accepted as trustworthy. For non-face-to-face methods of collecting expert opinion, they're going to be much harder to validate for the reasons that I showed. But I believe at a minimum that the criteria are going to have to, in order to decide whether it's trustworthy, it's going to have to be some description of whatever the process was, and then how many people contributed through what phases of that, and how that compared to the original guideline. And that's all I wanted to say, and I'll be happy to take questions when we're done.